You want to go on through criminal justice, or you want to go back and pick up where we were yesterday with the ordinances?
Yeah, I think the BP's lost that pretty good.
Okay.
Let's go back and pick up the ordinances and get that out of the way. Finish that up.
Well, we finished the occupational.
Right.
And the next we have in there is the ordinance on water and sewer. This is a little newer. It's adopted in 2002.
Well, not all of it, and that's one of the problems, and one of our biggest problems with water and sewer, in addition to whatever changes the commission would like to make based on the discussions this weekend, we'd like to start to research. The water sewer ordinance is in 10 or 12 pieces. This is very similar to what we had with the alcohol ordinance before it was redone. So if we have a developer or someone who's considering something or whatever come in and say, I'd like a copy of your water sewer ordinance, we have to track down and pull out about 10 pieces for them to have it all. And it just makes it difficult and not very customer friendly for them to be able to understand. So what we would like to do, in addition to any changes you all would like to make, is just to work towards having the county attorney consolidate all of the water sewer ordinances back into one that we can then update as it needs to instead of having all these pieces.
And if there again anything that issues that you have encountered that you would like for us to consider adding in there for discussion by the board, just let us know.
I'm gonna throw one out there that I think is important on something that as we begin to look at expanding our water and sewer system that we may want to consider. Is it possible in the ordinance? I know that we have the ordinance says now that if you're within 500 feet, you must connect.
But It is possible for us to look at that 1,000 foot. There's nothing sacred about that. I think this, and Commissioner Evans can probably give more history on it, but I think this began when there was movement from the health department. They were concerned about the number of septic tanks and so forth in development, and then the county was trying to get their system up and running, and that was the way they determined that 1,000 foot mark. So certainly it's within. Well,
is it because of that?
But I think maybe that if you want to look at that, that we should maybe give Steve some directions based on some of the ideas that you, I believe, have kind of given a head nod from the standpoint of this is at least a concept that staff needs to be continuing to work toward, and see what that connection would be if we look at 2,000 feet or 2,500 or whatever that is. So you will have a little bit more statistical data to look at as far as what that might
be. And here's a little bit of rationale behind that thing. I feel real strong about, we've got a good map there now that says what our water and sewer infrastructure is going to look like. I think once we do that, or at least once we do that and get finalize all that, then we should make every effort that we can to meet with local developers to say, here's where our infrastructure is. Here are the areas covered in these areas that's within whatever that distance is that we require. This is where you're going to be required to have water and sewer connections. What that does, as much as anything, is that it helps them identify properties that's in Lowndes County that they can begin to look at potentially for development. Now, you can look at our system the way it is, and it's going to be a long, long time before we ever get to a point from Lowndes County that we can, that we'll ever be able to say that we can serve everybody in Lowndes County. That's way down the road. But reality is there is a lot of areas right there that are close in. It will give you an effort to kind of control. And I know that's a bad word for a lot of people, but certainly to control some of that sprawl of growth out into the rural areas, because what you actually do then is that you show them where your areas are, where you're going to serve, and then if they choose, well, I don't want to go there, I'm going to jump out here, then that's a little bit different issue. But I believe that if you show them where you can serve the areas, show them also that it's not going to cost them any more to get served than what it's currently costing them to get served, but yet put a little bit more obligation on us, realizing that, yeah, we'll have some expense, but based on the area that we're already are willing to expand the system into, to say we'll run to that subdivision. And it may be something that you want to put some, to take and broaden it a little bit. You know, if you've got somebody jumps out there on 10 acres and develops a little 25 houses, I'll say, in that subdivision, we've got to decide whether at that point in time, whether it's worth for us, worth it financially for the county to go do that. But if somebody wants to put in 100 pieces, 100 lots that's close to that infrastructure, then definitely we need, if we're going to take advantage and continue to grow and expand that system, so that the services that we can provide to the citizens of Lowndes County will eventually begin to come down because you're getting more users on the systems. And that's the reason why I asked the question to Steve about capacity of the spray field. I just wanted to make sure, you know, where we're at with growth. I think that that's something that we've got to seriously start to look at and consider. But I think the thing is that not going to cost developers any more money to develop a piece of property because their connection is going to be in what's in the current ordinance, their cost. It will cost us in order to expand, but I think we're going to have to look at, are we going, if we're going to spend the money on the infrastructure, are we going to then be willing to go out there and take advantage of that infrastructure to be able to develop a custom for that infrastructure?
Is it possible to make an adjustment to our comprehensive plan in line with what you're saying? That it requires.
Yeah, well, I think you can do that, and I think.
The lots require a 1 acre lot out in the county.
I don't.
Stay away from this Nelson Hill business where it's happening there like Florida.
I don't think you can do that, Mark, and I don't mind getting waiting off into that board a little bit, but let me tell you why you can't, why that's a difficult call. There is such a thing as a need for affordable housing in our community, and like Nelson Hill or don't like Nelson Hill, you take it for wherever your position is. At $135,000 for a house and a home for a family to move into as starter homes, there is a need in this community for that particular market. If you took that house and put that house on 2 acres, that'd be $175,000 or $200,000 piece of property. But that's just the reality of it.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about the future and the future headaches, and the future slums, and the future problems with stuff like that. Like food.
No, that's not fair, though.
Yeah.
We have to meet the needs of everyone.
I'm all for growth. I have nothing against growth and progress and all that. It's just, I think we need smarter growth.
But everybody can't live. I mean, we've all been blessed somewhat. I mean, everybody can't live the lifestyle that we do and afford the homes that we're privileged enough to be. Like Chairman said, there is a need for affordable housing. And I think everybody using the term blue is really not. It's really not fair. Yeah, in hindsight, was that a mistake or not? I guess you could debate that. But the technology of the new construction now, I don't know that you're going to see much of that anymore. What people don't like about blue pool, I think, is that it's turned into a rental and it's dilapidated looking for some quality and type of materials used. But there's a stark contrast between blue pool and Nelson Hill. And I don't think we need to lump those two together. And when I say about construction technology, I mean, everything in Nelson Hill, it's not for me. But it serves a need.
But it's really not safe there. Well, if you've got a fire on the west end and a wind, it burns on the whole side of that place.
We've done had a test on a fire. And they get by.
There was one out there. You get the right wind.
We responded well.
But really, that's my concern.
Well, I understand it's not certain, but
not just the future. Of what it can turn into, and what normally happens in these places, starter homes, right, Scott, and people graduate up, well, they will keep that and turn it into a rental.
Mm-hmm.
Next thing you do, you've got all this mess there. You've got people parking in the front yard, and you've got bulldogs changing the trees and all this craziness.
But Mark, listen, if you go down Blue Pool today, if you want to use that as an example, I would tell you right now, more than likely, that's probably better than a 95% occupancy rate throughout that whole subject. It goes back to the fact that some people can't purchase. They have no other choice but to rent. And so they rent for that need. And so again, and they're looking for affordable rent space. It's still housing for the citizens that's in your community, like it or not. I mean, there's some that says that we don't like Conner Rose and we don't like Brookwood Drive, but reality is that it does serve a need for population in our community.
So are you going to say no more trailer parks and parks built based on that same lunch? I mean, we need just outlaw trailer parks and parking complexes because they're too close together and they can look bad in a few years.
I'm really not all that thrilled about trailer parks.
There's a need there, brother. I live in a trailer park 2/3 of mine growing up.
Good apartments. I don't see a problem with that.
But it's all about
after these apartments.
I don't think you are. I think that you, now the difference is what you want to look at, and I look at this, take Nelson Hill. probably not a single house in Nelson Hill that the developer is building that is not sold. They're building them and selling them just as far as they can go. That's not just happening because there's no need. The need is apparently there for that particular type of housing. And all types of housing and shelter for the citizens in a community has its place and has its need. Now, do we have situations with blighted areas? Do we have situations with, and I don't mind saying, slumlords that don't take care of their properties, don't maintain their properties like they should? Absolutely, there's those issues. But those are issues that is difficult for us to deal with as local government. That gets back to those individuals that own those properties, and then the individuals that choose to rent that piece of property.
Which isn't the characteristic of our community based on being a military community and a college university community indicative of a higher rental need?
Absolutely.
So there is a market for that, but we also know that the health of a community is improved when you have an increase in homeownership. Mm-hmm. So you're trying to find, as a commission, a balance between encouraging that homeownership and providing a rental market for those two segments that are huge economic engines in our community. So it's not really an either or, it's how you find the balance of both of those. And if you want to work with your ULDC as far as planned community developments, such as Nelson Hill, whatever, and requiring perhaps more green space or recreational areas that go along in that would make the community maybe more acceptable to somebody with the position of Mark, but still meet the needs of that homeownership.
The bottom line is not converting you as hard. You're a good person, you know, a house and buy a place, and they want to do their property, they're not going to need to go back to someone.
Well, keep in mind also that we more so today than probably we've ever been in the history of Lowndes County, we are becoming, because of the base, because of the college, and because of other industries, a more diverse community. We've got people that's moving into our community that is accustomed to high-density subdivisions. That's not something, there's nobody going to a Nelson Hill subdivision saying, good gosh, I wish I could go anywhere here. They make a decision to make a purchase in that subdivision because they like the house and they like the subdivision. Maybe they like that low maintenance issue or small yards and you know, not the bigger, you know, acre lots and those sort of things. They're, again,
what is the size?
Serving a need.
There's the lot size of it.
Maybe 4 acre.
But I'm with this note as far as like the reflection, as far as you guys talking about this, if you look behind this blue tab, there's a list there that Jason put together for you all over the last year of what the rezoning requests have been, along with how many lots were impacted and the request for the zoning to go from where to where. And then that's reflected on this map too. So when you have time to go through and look at that, you can see what the need has been related to that over the past.
And it's really reflective of, not that information before, the market is reflective of what the public wants.
Absolutely.
If you go to Georgetown and you experience row houses, or in other cities in the United States, they're all packed in there, and there are, there's only a little bit of yard out the back.
I spent the weekend in New Orleans and they built, you can't even walk between them. I mean, they're that close, just house after house.
But it's not something that we kind of, that we're accustomed to, so it's not something that we readily accept.
I agree.
So another thing, Debbie, you're talking about, not cheap.
Nothing is
the only expensive in the choice I heard you talk about in DC.
But you know, if you look at the, from the 50s and 60s when housing projects or housing developments began, they're the same concept of a road type housing.
I don't mean to get into a heated discussion of this, but when people talk about Blue Pool, I do really take exception to it. Because the people that's living in Blue Pool live in Blue Pool because that's what they can afford to have. That's,
I'm not talking
that's
about
where
people's income or anything like that. But I was mainly talking about us developing smarter and safer and trying to stay away from these places that eventually turn into these crime. I wasn't talking about what people can afford.
I understand that. I know, but
like he just said, that Georgetown, they're in there tight. The price is up here.
But the two of them mesh together, though. I mean, they mesh together. The less density you have in a subdivision, the higher the cost of that lot and that home's going to be. So they do mesh together because in order to be able to have affordability so that somebody can afford the home to start with, the only way they can get there is, in most cases, is with the density. And there's a lot of people, as I said earlier, that comes into this subdivision that density is not an issue with. So I think we have to be conscious about how it's done, but I think also we need to be open-minded enough that whatever the market is requesting, when a developer goes out and puts in a subdivision, he already has a pretty good idea that the market, there's a shortage in the market for that specific product. And that's what my
this money's good.
Go,
you know that.
I know it's that, but there's
I was in the real estate business over 15 years and I've seen this thing evolve where it is. But
when the market, the difference between the difference between a realtor and being realistic is you'd rather go out there and make a sale on a $300,000 home and get your percentage off of $300,000 than to come over here and sell that $135,000.
That's not true. Well, I sell anything. I sell mobile home, shacks, whatever. If I can get a listing or had a buyer, I'd sell it.
But the truth of the matter is, I mean, homes that sell new for a lower cost, you know, you put yourself at risk by doing that because, you know, let's, you can argue, I guess, that $100,000 house, you got more risk of somebody coming in and not caring about it. So, but you can't say, we're not going to do any more of that. We're only going to cater to someone who can afford $200,000. Everybody else, if you want to live, work, if you want to work and play here, you're going to live over in Brooks or somewhere, or Eccles or somewhere else in a $100,000 trailer. And then, you know, we still want you to come spend your money and stuff in our community, but we're not going to provide housing.
Is it safe to say you want us to get back with Steve and look at the distance?
It's safe to say, I'm sorry, yeah. We digress a little bit.
The next.
But wait, I don't want to belabor that, but I want to make sure I understand. Are you saying that we're considering the possibility of 3,000 feet, let's just use that as a hypothetical?
5 miles?
5 miles. They're still in this 1,000 foot.
That's correct.
So then we have to move from that 5 mile up to that 1,000 feet away point.
Where we're at right now as a county is that it's an all or nothing. You pay 1,000 to get water and sewer, or we don't serve it, and we don't get that. So again, we're getting more of these private well systems, these community well systems, simply because he goes out there to 1,001 feet and says, I'm going to put in a community well system.
So are we saying we're going to take this map that's got our water and sewer, future water and sewer connections, and we're saying we're going to, maybe not realistic, or maybe not literally, but we're going to draw a box, and we're going to highlight an area that's within 1,000 feet, and we're going to say, here's where we want you, Mr. Development Community, to target. target your, which in turn is going to drive the values of those up, and then the values of everything outside of that down. And we're going to say no development. You know, we're prepared to say
no,
not encouraging any development in this area. If you choose to develop, you're still going to be required to tie in within 5 miles, but it's going to be at your expense.
No. I'm saying that the county's going to be responsible for the 5 miles. You're going to be responsible for the last 1,000 feet. No more cost difference to the developer than what it is right now, if you wanted to use that analogy. The key is that right now we're telling developers, if you're within 1,000 feet, you have to tie on. Not a question of whether we want to go ahead and bring it to that 1,000-foot mark and then say you've got to tie on. But if you're within 1,000 feet, you have to tie. What I'd like to do is to say, if you're within 3,000 feet, then that development has to have county water and sewer. It is going to be the county's responsibility to go 2,000 feet and the developer to go that other 1,000 feet. It's going to cost him no different per lot than what it would have costed him if he was within that 1,000 feet. It's just giving the county the opportunity to grow that infrastructure a little bit more because you're broadening that distance. If you've got somebody that's up on the north or the south right there and they're over 1,000 feet from that system, they don't even have to think about county water.
Steve brought the numbers down a while ago that we talked a little bit about yesterday as far as the private water systems go. And the example that he got from a local developer on the current location was 100 half-acre lots. About 6,000 feet of 6-inch pipe at $4,600 a lot was the developer's investment with that. And then if you take into consideration the average flat rate that a lot of these private water systems are charging, that lot's profitable on that water system within 7 to 7.5 years. And that's being built to the county standards already with that 6-inch.
So they're getting their return on their investment in 7 years?
Yes.
Right.
Yes, right.
So my point is that the county has the opportunity as well to get a return on their investment and to grow the system by requiring a closer bid, allowing, actually saying if you're within 3,000 feet, you've got to tie. No more expense to you, you still got that 1,000, but we're just going to pick up the rest.
The other thing I'd like to check into is I'm unclear on what the zoning board feels, what their authority is. Appeals related to that 1,000 feet. It seems like I remember several cases in my past that they had the ability to waive that through the appeals process. I can't remember.
We did hear a case at Lake Galapagos, which we turned down.